welcome. Today we're going to do a cool, hopefully, live coding session. And I've brought two experts on the phone to help me implement an open source issue. This is how it's called in GitHub. Thorsten and Raphael, welcome to the show.
Hey.
Hi.
What are we going to look at today? We're going to start with looking at a project that Thorsten initiated a few weeks ago. No, it's not week. It's month, right, Thorsten?
Yeah, several months, I think.
And the project is focused on something that is very close to my and Thorsten's heart, which is automation. And it is called projen-pipelines. I've talked about it recently already on the channel, so feel free to have a look. We brought Raphael on because Raphael, in the way that I've seen in the last few shows, is very cool in live coding and also very interested in projen, and also has some interest in Wing App, and I have a challenge for him to implement today. And we're going to see how far we get in about 30 minutes. So, Thorsten, maybe you can talk a little bit about the project just a few seconds, and then we're going to look at the issue that we're going to try to implement today.
Yeah, sure. So, as I said, I've initiated this several months ago, and it's the idea of creating your CI/CD pipelines also from code. So if you're using projen as a means or as a tool to create all your project files, you can also use projen to create your CI/CD pipelines. And the idea is to be engine agnostic. So you define basically how your engine and how your pipeline should look like with your basic deployment setup and also several things like testing and stages and all the things. And then you decide, yeah, I want to render this into GitHub or Code Catalyst or GitLab or sometimes Jenkins or whatever you want to do. And you can switch your engines if you want to move your CI/CD provider. That's the basic idea. And you don't need to reinvent everything for every pipeline. It's always the same how to deploy a CDK app.
Cool. And today our project supports a CDK app. So this means that we can take a standard CDK application with ProGen. We can then say render the workflows for it, and the workflows can be rendered today into GitHub and into GitLab workflows, as far as I remember, right?
GitHub, GitLab, and a so-called bash workflow, which means it's just generating the ProGen scripts and it's creating a markdown file, what you need to call in which order, which you then can use to build your own pipelines in these engines or just use any other CI/CD tool manually.
Cool. And that brings us to what I had as an idea for implementing together today, which is an issue that we have opened already last year. And maybe I didn't write it as good as it should have been, but it was meant to implement a Winlang pipeline. So this means Winlang, Raphael, you can give an insight into what Winlang actually is and why it is interesting for us.
Sure. So Winlang is a project from the same founder than the AWS CDK project was. So it's Elad Ben Israel. And what they try to achieve is do another abstraction of the cloud. So you use well-defined interfaces to interact with cloud resources like functions, buckets, queues, topics, and so ever. And you define those resources on an interaction level. So you just say, okay, I have a bucket or I have a queue, and whenever there's a new message on the queue, then I only define a handler for a new message, and all the wiring up between the runtime code, they call it in-flight code, and the static resources that need to be deployed to a cloud provider are all wired up automatically by only defining how the behavior of your cloud application should look like. And for that, they define their own programming language. It's similar to well-known languages like JavaScript, but has some caveats. And it, in the end, transpiles some cloud simplified, whatever you say, for example, for Terraform or even AWS CDK, which then can be deployed to your cloud provider. And it's not only for AWS, their goal is also to deploy to other cloud providers like Azure or Google Cloud in the future. I think some of the resources are already implemented, but in the end, you can easily transfer your applications from one cloud service to another.
Cool. Thank you so much for that intro. And you have been using Winlang a bit, as far as I remember. That means that you also contributed to it in an open source world. So you feel at home when we talk about open source contributions.
Yes, and I heard that's amazing. The first time prior to reInvent, and then I got into touch with the team and implemented one resource, the API resource. And yeah, it was a big open source contribution for me because I haven't done it before. But yeah. I know Winlang a few.
Yeah, thank you so much for all of the work that you do in open source, Thorsten, as well. You with all of the projen work and CDK work that you have been already also doing before. So I want to take you both as experts to help me look at this issue and hopefully start a journey into getting this implemented in projen pipelines. So the issue that I had written up a few years ago, no, month ago, was about now, instead of using a CDK app that I want to push through my pipeline, I want to have a Winlang pipeline that I would want to do push through the pipeline. So, Thorsten, how would you, because you're the projen pipelines expert, how would you start this issue when you look at it? And let's try to do a kind of pre-planning of the implementation for the next 5 to 6 minutes, and then we're going to jump over to code with Raphael.
Yeah, sure. So I'm not the Wing expert, as I said. So it's up to Raphael to decide what the actual commands would be. But in general, when implementing a new pipeline, the idea is to lay out the steps that you want to call and then group these steps into, most engines call it stages. So like we want to compile our code, we want to package it up, or we want to create some assets, we want to run some tests on it. And normally then we want to deploy. And deployment can be multiple stages. We want to deploy a development environment, a feature environment, a production environment. That should be obviously configurable because every customer, every user has a different number of stages. Some have one because you only live once. So let's push to production all the time. And some have, like, I've seen up to 7 stages for CI/CD pipelines. So that should definitely be configurable. And that would be the thing. And then I think the easiest way is to implement one engine, then implement this, see what the second engine would have in common and what not, and create an abstraction out of that, and then see what can be shared and what should be resource-specific or engine-specific implementation of the pipeline inside projen pipelines.
And an engine for you means a specific CI/CD provider.
Yeah, so the engine in projen pipelines, we call these engines. So we have the GitLab engine, we have a GitHub engine, we have the Bash engine, we have the later the Code Catalyst and Jenkins and whatever engines. So that's when I call engine, I mean like the provider that we are running it on.
Cool. So I've tried to take notes. First thing, before starting code, we need to identify the steps that we need to be executed as part of the pipeline. Second, we need to identify the stages required for a Winlang application in default, however we want to have that, and make them configurable, is I think what you said.
Yeah.
Third one is implement one engine and find out what are common scenarios for other engines, and then implement all currently supported engines by projen pipelines. Cool. Exactly. Now, Raphael, you as the Wing expert, can you get started with that? Is this good enough for you to kick it off?
So what I need is basically know which stages or steps are right now implemented in the pipeline, so we can have a look of which other corresponding Wing commands or steps to do that.
Okay. That means...
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so basically there's two ways. We can start it from scratch and just look at the documentation of Wing and see how it is done. If we already have some example GitHub or GitLab pipeline, we can look at that and see how can we abstract this. Or if we say, yeah, it's maybe it's similar to CDK, so we use the CDK implementation as a baseline, copy that and change all the commands. So these are basically the three approaches that we can take.
I think we should start with the documentation of Winlang there to get an overview how they recommend deploying stuff, and then maybe discuss if we do it one by one like the documentation does, or if we caveat from that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Reading doc is always a good first step.
Winlang is on GitHub as well, but there is also a website, and as you can see, I already had a look on how to deploy Winlang apps to AWS. So it starts with going to winlang.io, and then there's installation, run locally, and deploy to AWS. And I think the deploy to AWS piece is the one, Raphael, that you wanted to look at, right?
Yes. One thing from the installation part is we need to have installed the Winlang CLI, and that is probably the first step we need to have in our pipeline setup, so that our runner that is executing the pipeline has access to this Winlang CLI tool.
And so one question from my side here, is this an its own project type, or is so are we running inside a node project, or is it just a new completely new structure and there's nothing else like package JSON and so on?
There is no package JSON or so on. Okay. You only have to be the
Wing code.
The Winlang executable needs to be installed in your environment.
Yeah. Because otherwise I would have
there might be some configuration files if you pull in some external modules, but as a getting starting point, we don't need any of this.
Okay.
And once we have, then maybe go back to deploy to AWS. Once we have the CLI installed, we will need to compile to one of the targets. So as I already mentioned, Wing has a capability to generate code for multiple platforms, and the documentation in the Getting Starting Guide says they recommend to use a Terraform provider because that's the most advanced or most developed target for now. But they also support other targets or other platforms like AWS CDK. So if you want to deploy to AWS, we have two options, and we can now decide if we want to go with Terraform or do we want to use CDK as a platform to deploy.
So this means instead of calling out platform TF AWS, I can also say CDK as a platform target?
Yes.
And what's the output of that then?
The output is the same as if you were to run AWS CDK synth. So it generates a cdk.out folder, and within there, all the assets that are relevant to deploying to your cloud provider are in it.
That sounds maybe, Thorsten, like something we could reuse. What do you think?
Yeah, so I love the CDK, and normally I'm always in favor of the CDK. Currently, I'm thinking like the promise of Wing is to be platform independent. So if you now generate CDK, you lose that feature. So
I think
Raphael, is what you want to do? I think if we said we read the documentation. So if we read the documentation and the documentation says use Terraform, maybe use Terraform. But it's not to do CDK and see how much we can reuse from the CDK code. Reusing the CDK part there will be something we can reuse, and there will be some things like that will lead us in the wrong direction because we try to make it the same. So it's a balance. So
How would you change this if you want to deploy to CD to Google Cloud? I think it's not. Is it available already? Yeah.
Yeah, we need to check the specific platform name. It should be somewhere in the documentation, hopefully, if you switch to documentation. The third one, docs.
I'm too
third on the top level navigation, there are three. The third item is docs, and it is the same link.
Yes.
Platform.
Bit
Oh,
dense.
the end there was a point platforms.
Platforms.
And it's probably AWS CDK, all without any
or
items.
TFTP or TF Azure, yes.
Yeah, so this looks like we need a Terraform pipeline actually instead of a Winglang pipeline, because with that we could keep that Winglang agnostic, that cloud agnostic thing with Winglang. And then if we would have Terraform support, maybe that would already solve other problems in Progen as well.
Yeah, so I would say let's start with a Terraform approach focused on Winglang. And maybe in some follow-up, we then see what would be the generic Terraform part of that.
Cool. So then this gets an update, right? Because we kind of found out now that it's not as easy as kind of doing that. So we're going to try with a Terraform approach, because Winglang transpiles to Terraform. Okay.
So we need to have a CDK, a pipeline that supports Terraform as an input.
Yeah, I think that the first step would just be to have this as an implementation detail of the Wing pipeline. And then see if later we can extract the Terraform pipeline and we can derive from that.
Makes sense.
But first of all, make it work and then make it nice. So I would say we create a Wing pipeline that is just using Terraform. And then see if we can generalize this, or if there's a separate Terraform pipeline that's just calling the same commands.
Okay.
Abstraction is nice, but sometimes it's also a lot of ifs and elses then.
Good. And we have about 15 minutes left to look into some code. That means we're not going to get far today, but without kind of any further ado, maybe we can jump over and look at Raphael. How would you start and approach this issue now that you, that we kind of have a common understanding what we're going to implement?
So maybe should I share my screen or? Yeah,
it would be better, I guess, because then people can see how you also approach this kind of stuff. Like,
this is the right one, share. Probably I would start, if I want to contribute to a project like the Progen Pipelines project, I would start by looking for getting started README. Or the README, basically, and look for a getting started section in this case. And this is probably the usage, but maybe is there a contribution guideline? Contributing for raising feature requests or issues, of course, by committing code. So we want to do something. First thing is clone and fork the repository, as always. So let's do that quickly. Fork the repository so we can actually push to some changes. The fork button is over here. And I want to fork it to my GitHub account. Give it the same name and just create a fork. So
Thorsten,
now
I reason,
have a copy.
What's the
of,
reason for using a fork?
The reason is because I probably make some Git commits and I cannot commit to Thorsten's project because I'm not part of the contributors of the project. So I have a copy of, or a fork of the original project, and there I can create branches and make my contributions ready. And then I'm generating a pull request or opening a pull request to notify the owner of the repository to say, okay, hi, here's my changes. I propose to do your project. I already made them in my project. And then if the pull request gets merged, the actual code changes are moved from my fork repository into the original project. So now the next thing is probably clone it to my local machine. Let's open up a code editor and go to the terminal and simply resize Git repo clone. Now it's on the my namespace and this project name. It's cloning into the project, into the folder. And then I'm seeing, is it here? It is in cd projen pipelines and added to my IDE. So code minus a dot. Yes, I trust the author of these files. Trust my trust.
Thank you for that.
And now if I see the project, the workspace folder in my IDE, I have at least all the files ready. So go back to the getting started documentation and see what's next. So we cloned it, we checked out the thing. We should create a new branch. Not sure if we need that. Make sure it changes. Test your changes, commit your changes. So basically we are now ready to make some changes. So Thorsten, how could I create a new pipeline type for my Winglang application?
First of all, really create a new branch. And it's something that you should always do when creating a fork, because maybe you want to work on different things. And if you pollute your own main branch on your fork, you cannot do a second change until the pull request is done. And then you need to remove your fork and create a new one. So it's always easier to create branches. To be able to also, like, if something changes in the upstream, so in the main project pipelines, you can just update your main branch and merge it. So it's way easier if you're working on a branch, even if it's your own fork.
Cool. That's a good point. So now I have my own branch, feature Winglang pipeline.
Perfect. And first of all, in the source folder, if you look into the source folder, we see that for CDK, there's its own subfolder because we have the implementations for different engines. So it's a lot of files and it makes sense to group this into folders. We would create a new folder, Winglang. And then inside this folder, we start by implementing, having the index.ts. So just hooking up things so it just works, create an index.ts. And then going into the main index.ts, re-export it so we don't forget that in the index.ts of the whole of the folder. Yeah, so it's re-exported that we have the things. Another user of Q.
He's trying
that's totally expected because you're not exporting anything yet from Winglang, but that's always the line you miss and then you're wondering why it doesn't work. That's why I always start with the re-exporting, even if it's red, because you always forget this line and then I implement it. Why don't I see it?
Makes sense. Yeah.
So, and then we start with creating another file, and I think I would start with implementing one engine. So it's always hard to abstract when you don't see different use cases of it. So just do the GitHub TS. And there we can start. As it's a project, we normally have an options interface and the class implementing it.
So should we have a look at the other implementation from CDK as a reference to?
Yeah, you can definitely have a look there. So we have the...
Oh, I haven't installed dependency, probably. It is NPM or...?
It's using Yarn. Yarn Classic. Currently, we might switch that to NPM because basically this is what the Progen team is currently proposing, because Yarn Classic is outdated. Yarn Berry, so the new Yarn, is not yet implemented in Progen, so using NPM.
Cool. So this is basically defining some configurations.
That's a nested object. So if you scroll down a bit, there is the GitHub pipeline options line, starting line 27, which basically is like, this is the options for our CDK pipeline for GitHub. And we want to create a similar interface for these are the options that we need. And these options would be like, what stages are there? What's the IAM roles to deploy to AWS? And what runners to use on GitHub and all the things.
Okay, and then we are creating an instance of type CDK pipeline. Do we also instantiate a CDK pipeline?
No, that would be our base class. So that's exactly the thing. So in the end, we will have a winglang pipeline and then a GitHub winglang pipeline. But let's start with one and then extract to this generic winglang pipeline later. So we would have a GitHub winglang pipeline, and the constructor there will just create all the things. So it will create a new workflow in GitHub, add the triggers, add the jobs, and so on and so forth.
Is there any base class I can extend, or do I have to define a new one?
So there's no superclass. It's a normal projen component.
Okay.
So that's the same thing of generalizing it. So you generalize or abstract things after you have multiple. So the moment your winglang pipeline is there, we can see what are the similarities and how can we create a projen pipeline superclass for things that all the pipelines need, no matter what engine and no matter what project type they use. But it's always hard to abstract this before because you always abstract the wrong part.
Okay.
So, we would now create a class, GitHub winglang pipeline. And we are extending component from projen.
From projen. Okay.
Yeah. And then we are creating the constructor, and the constructor is projen project as a first argument. If we are using a projen project, and it should be one. So yeah, it's project of type project, I think, because we don't have any specific things. So it's not a TypeScript project or a Java project because it's a wing project, and the wing project is not yet there. So in the perfect world, we would create a wing project component in projen itself. And the second would be the options. Of type, yeah, that's perfect. I love Q.
I think it's Copilot.
It's Copilot, yeah, because Q does the same things. And it would be an interface. So creating an interface where we put all the options that we want to use.
What are the options now? Do we need?
So the options would be, what stages do we want to deploy to, and what? That depends on that's where now you come up with wing experts. So what are the things that make up the configurability of our pipeline? So how many environments do we have, and the GitHub specific things like what will be the IAM roles if we deploy to AWS? What would be the configuration options to deploy to Azure or whatever.
Yeah,
so all the things that are dynamically defined by the user when creating these pipeline objects later.
So essentially, target provider could be one.
Right? Yeah, that's what I'm asking. Do we build a pipeline specific for one platform like AWS, or do we build a generic winglang?
I think it should be generic winglang, as winglang is generic or is supposed to be generic. So maybe the target platform or whatever, right? Could be.
Yeah. Let's start with string and make it nice later on.
I have some problems with the formatter. Not sure how to. Do you use Prettier in this project?
I don't think so.
Okay.
And we have 5 minutes left.
We'll fix it later. So let's say we need to specify a target, and for now we're only supporting Terraform for AWS.
Yeah. So the next steps would then be in the constructor to start defining our workflow. So we create a new workflow by Let's see if our project, so I think you called it scope, has this. So do scope.github or project. Yeah, you called it project. That's totally fine. Just wondering because it was like GitHub. Let's see if this is. No, so the normal project doesn't have it. Then let's create our own. It's called GitHub. Well, let's extend the GitHub project. So that's something that's currently in the works in Progen. Not here. Sorry.
In the extension
scope of type GitHub project instead of project, which is basically the same right now. It's just it's deprecated. Let's use it. They're just moving this to something else because there is this high bundling to GitHub right now in Progen, and they want to get rid of that. But they didn't get rid of it yet, so we can still use it. And that's exactly what we don't want to do. Add workflow. Call it whatever we want. So the first parameter, it's just one parameter and it's a name. It could be like deployment or deploy. So it will be the name of the GitHub file.
And this creates now the first workflow in GitHub, essentially, right?
So that creates a dot in dot GitHub slash workflow slash deploy dot YAML. And now we store this workflow to a member variable, and then we can add to this all the time. I would directly put it on the on the class because this is something we will need all the time. Workflow, and it's of type GitHub workflow, not GitHub project.
You made it read only.
No, the thing is, do GitHub exclamation mark. The GitHub is optional, but we know that it's there because it's a GitHub project.
Okay, got it.
It's TypeScript. It's always fun. And then on this workflow, we can add things. So the first we want to do is create a trigger. So we do this.workflow.on. Yeah, perfect. Like, I just love AI. Push branches main, that's perfectly fine. And let's also do an empty object on workflow dispatch. So under the push, do another, within the currently thing, one line down, after the push, there's also workflow dispatch.
That means we will be able to start it manually.
Yeah, just like this, exactly. With the empty brackets, just hit tab. So it's triggering on main, and it's also triggering when we click on the run now button. That's always good for tests.
And we need to add it to the current branch as well, because otherwise the workflow dispatch only works after the main merge to main. So if you now want to test that on your own branch, that's not true. That's bullshit what I'm saying.
Workflow dispatch will always run, I think.
Workflow dispatch works on all the things, and otherwise it's just pushing on main, and you don't want to push all the time with empty commits to fix your pipeline.
Yeah.
Especially if it's something outside, like, oh yeah, my IAM role was wrong. Which never happens. And then we define the steps that we want to create. So we can now call, to make it a bit nicer, we can call member methods for the different things you want to do. So we need to have a synthesize or compile stage, as it's called in Wing, as I understood. So let's do this.createCompile. Let's call it createCompile, and we create a method that's doing that. Otherwise, it's everything in one constructor, which is a bit long.
So define a member function of this class.
Yeah, like
Okay.
create, compile.
Function. Oops.
It's a class, you don't need function, you can just do private. Private method, yeah.
And we want to call it.
Create compile. I'm always calling it create because there is a lot of things. We cannot call it get because of JSII. We cannot. There's a lot of prefixes we can't use because of JSII. So and that's because basically we can use this now our progen thing not only in TypeScript but in Java or Python or whatever.
And
So.
that's, I'm sorry, the time when we plan to end for today, as we are all busy. At least I have a follow-up that I need to go to if for our recording.
Yeah.
So my proposal would be, Raphael, let's wrap up here and let's see that we just leave everything as it is and we get together again maybe next week or the week after next, and we continue from here and see how we get this done. I think that would be really a good thing. It's a great learning, also on how to contribute to project pipelines, which we would love to also get more people to contribute to.
Sounds perfect.
I'm still waiting till Raphael stops, but I can see him excited. I think we should finish off with committing and maybe
Committing
pushing
and
it to GitHub,
pushing.
right?
Yeah.
And that would be, and that's why it's great to have a branch here as well.
My most famous commit message is rip.
And you always use update. That's also a very famous commit message from me.
For me, it's always progress.
Also good. Cool. Thank you so much, guys. This was really cool to see this, how to get this started as well. And I think we made a good step into also now getting this really implemented. And yeah, we're gonna see that we do a follow up directly and have a great rest of your day.
See you. Bye-bye.
Welcome back. We are now gonna continue our implementation of the Winglang app in Progen Pipeline. So, Raphael, where did we get stuck last time?
So we added a workflow to our project. So now we have a workflow file in our repository, and we modified the workflow file to trigger whenever there's a commit on the main branch or manually triggering the pipeline by clicking the UI element for workflow dispatch.
Okay, cool. So, Thorsten, what's next?
So the next steps would be to create the jobs. That we want to execute and hook them up in the workflow file. The first one would be the compile. So compiling the Winglang code to Terraform.
Then.
Okay, so I'm creating the create compile function.
Yes. You would create this function. There's some parentheses missing, and then.
Oh. Parentheses are
Yeah, here. Yeah. The function arguments. So there's
oh, yeah. Okay,
yeah,
yeah.
now it's working. So let's see. We have the create compile. So first of all, we would. Yep, that sounds good. Let's do copilot. Yeah, so we need this new job.
Job is an object.
Yeah, let's move the add job to the bottom. It looked good, but it wasn't. And let's create the steps as an array. So let's create a new array of the type job step. Oh, you're using all caps currently. I think that's not intended. Yeah, of type, there's a type called job step. You can just use that. instead of the any.
And this is what we reuse from progen existing.
Thing. That's the existing progen GitHub model.
Yeah, progen GitHub model, exactly.
So you can remove line 2728.
And that is an important information for people that want to implement this for GitLab or CodeCatalyst or Jenkins, right? That those models would be something that we would need to build ourselves for that piece, if it doesn't exist within progen.
Exactly. So now we add the steps to this array. The first is the checkout. Yeah, start with that. And then checkout, let's use checkout version 4 instead of version 2. And then let's see what we need. So are we running on Node? Do we not need Node? No, we don't have a package JSON, so we can add other steps that we want at this point.
We need if we are installing the global Winlang CLI tool, maybe?
Yes, that would be the next good step. So npm install -g.
Isn't there a Winlang action as well?
I don't think so.
I think there is. There is a Winlang GitHub action for deployment, but it's alpha, so let's not use it.
Let's stick to the guide from Winlang documentation.
Yeah, let's do that.
So it is Winlang, yeah. So now we should have the Winlang CLI at our hand.
Yeah, and then we do the compile.
It was wing compile, I think. Target, we wanted to use Terraform or CDK?
I think we wanted to use Terraform, but we had it as a variable in the top. So let's see if we...
Yeah, we had the target. For now, we only implemented Terraform for AWS, but we probably should reference our target. So how do we access the target variable?
So we would make the options protected. So go up in your constructor where it's called, where you're defining options, just write protected in front of it. So now we have field, and now we can do in a great compile, we can now do this dot
something like that.
Yes, exactly.
Cool. So now after our build process, if we have an output folder that contains all our Terraform assets or CDK assets, depending what target we have.
Yeah, and the final step would then to upload this as an artifact. And so I have another action. Yeah, upload artifact.
Come on, compile it.
Yeah, that sounds good. Upload artifact, also version 4 is the current one. And we give it a name, like the wing, whatever. Yeah, and the name of the artifact is in line 43, and that's something that should be, that we need to know how it is called, and it should be unique. So wing assembly or whatever. Artifact and the path that should be.
So I think the path is now also depending on the target. So if I'm if the target is Terraform, it is in a Terraform target, and otherwise maybe in a
in a CDK target.
But it will all go to the target directory using winglang compile, I guess, or not.
So
so reading the documentation, it looks like that.
Is it always a target, the same folder?
Yes, but then the file generated is different as far as I see it. So for AWS, in Terraform, it generates a main.tf and AWS as a name at the end.
So we can use the target folder as a general name.
Yes, that's what I was.
Okay, let's try that. But also, I noticed that we need to specify an entry file where the compile starts. So we not only have the target, we also need to have a starting point like main.w.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah, and within the.
Yeah. Or should we do that as a parameter as well?
Yeah, I think it should be a parameter because people might want to call it whatever they like.
Okay, so let's start with
wing entry point.
Wing entry point or entry file maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And it is a string, and then we can maybe we can fall back to main.w as a default and
make it optional.
Yeah.
So and maybe not, we're not gonna do that now, but in the guide from Wing, they say like if you use then npm or if you use node, you would also need to run npm install somewhere in the directory. Right, so I don't think that we're gonna need that here because we don't have any node stuff. But the guide points out that they are running npm install before actually doing the or npm CI before they actually execute wing.
If you have TypeScript files in your repo,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but winglang can be extended with regular JavaScript. And you can call any JavaScript function in your Wing application. And for that, if these JavaScript files have some additional dependencies, they need to be installed as well. So should we add it maybe just after the installation of the Winglang app, Winglang CLI install? Winglang CLI and install dependencies and just use npm CI.
But is this something that we need right now?
Not for our Hello World, so we can add it later.
Yes.
Yeah, because I think we can also make this conditionally on the type of the project, because we can assume that people will not be using a normal GitHub project, but a TypeScript project or a JavaScript project in Progen when using JavaScript stuff. And then we know that, oh yeah, this is a JavaScript project, so we call the npm CI calls and we can get this from Progen. So we just do Progen dependencies and things like that.
Okay, so let's continue. Now we have uploaded our build artifacts.
Yeah, and now let's finish our job. Here, add job. We can also call add job instead of add jobs.
And that expected two arguments.
Yeah, a name and the content. So the first one would be the name of the job. Exactly. And a job definition. And a job definition. Yeah, this can go away. It runs on. It's the name. We already have the name. Environment, if we need that. The steps, obviously.
Now it's complaining about runs on steps.
Yeah, but and the permissions are the next one. We also need a permissions object. And now we need to see what permissions it needs. It needs at least
artifacts and
no, you can write artifacts without permissions. You need contents read. So the contents.
Packages, right? We also need that because we upload an artifact.
Yeah, but it don't need permissions to do that, obviously. Yeah, job permission dot.
Okay.
We need a contents, I think, to do the checkout.
Let's see. Yeah. We'll troubleshoot it later, hopefully. Okay, cool. So now we have our workflow file with which has one job called compile, which runs on an Ubuntu latest machine on GitHub and has several job steps that are first starting with check out the repository code, then install the Winlang CLI, run our build command so we have some cloud assembly assets or something we can deploy. And this compiled artifact we then upload as an artifact to our GitHub store.
Exactly.
Cool.
And now we're missing the upload, the deploy step at the end, right? That's going to be a separate workflow, Thorsten?
It's a separate,
yeah.
It's not a separate workflow, but it's a separate job.
Ah, yeah, of course.
And it will also be a separate method that we're using to create this because we will call this multiple times. Because we have an array of stages and we will do this for every stage. So in our constructor, we first need to call a create compile because currently nothing is happening with it.
So that means that we're in projen-pipelines, we are following the best practice of compile once and then deploy many, many times?
Exactly. That's what we always should do because if you recompile, we can just skip testing in the test environments because we build something new for production.
Okay, so now we're going to have multiple deployments being executed to different stages, depending on the number of stages that we have, and that's the next job that we need to add to the workflow.
Exactly. So now, after the create compile, we can do an iteration over our stages array, and then call create deployment with the respective stage.
How does Copilot know what we want to do? I think he's listening.
Probably listening to us.
It's listening to us and doing what I said. Maybe we're not that clever. Maybe we just do what we should do. Yeah, that sounds very good. Let's just continue using that. So we're downloading the artifacts. Let's just switch it to version 4 again. Did I ever mention that I love Copilot and Code Whisperer?
It's not Code Whisperer anymore.
Yeah, it's Q for ID.
Yes.
Okay, let's check the wing deploy command. Is that one correct? So, because I'm not sure if there is a wing deploy command. I think it's a regular deploy command.
I assume that this is just hallucination. But yeah. The first ones are correct.
So in the guide it says Terraform init and Terraform apply. That's what we would need to do, but we would need to switch to the target directory. So in this case, we are now downloading the artifact. Then we're going to need to switch to target, and then we're going to run execute Terraform init and Terraform apply on that piece.
Actually, we need to build a deploy command depending on the target, I think, because depending on the target, now we are building a Terraform deploy command. If we have an artifact that is CDK or Google or something else, we probably need a different deploy command.
Yes.
Yeah, so I think we should even have separate deploy methods for that.
A completely different create deploy method or just a method that returns this step?
Because I think The only thing that they will share is downloading the artifact.
Okay, so we call this method create Terraform deploy. If this dot target options dot target Terraform AWS do this stuff, otherwise throw an error.
Yeah, you need an else, otherwise it will throw all the time.
Sure. For now, okay. So now we will focus on the Terraform deploy, and we need to...
We no longer need a Wing CLI, I think.
That's right as well.
So I think run is...
We need to switch to the working directory of target, correct?
Yeah.
And with that folder, we then...
But isn't there a Terraform action that we can use?
We could use...
You would need to install Terraform.
So there is a...
Should you look for one, or do you know one by heart?
I'm just looking for one.
Because there are already in GitHub Actions running, there are already Terraform assemblies installed. So if you do not need a specific version, there's always one version deployed.
So Terraform is already on
GitHub deployed. Actions. Yes.
Yeah, then let's just execute Terraform. There would be specific actions to use, but if we all don't have experience with them, let's not do that.
Yeah. So we will do tf init and then tf apply, I think.
So I need to do a multi-line comment, right?
You can either do multiple steps or just separate them with a double ampersand. Like do this and then do this and then do this. But we can also do different lines.
I prefer multiple lines.
Okay. Now, I'm not sure if we can do multi-line in the run command. So one run is one command, maybe. But that sounds good.
Depending on the output, it is so it is possible to do multiple multi-line comments in the basic YAML format. I'm not sure if this generator supports it out of the box. Trojan generator.
Let's see what happens. We don't need cd target because we set a working directory, but then it's apply, and we need to filter what to deploy. So I think we need to...
Also, the documentation says that we... So that is basically the documentation part. I just copy it over so we have it as a reference. They are saying we need to navigate to the target folder, and within the target folder we have another folder called by the entry file name .tfaws.
Okay, so working directory would be /entry file aws.
Yes, this would be probably something like that. This dot options, not target. We want to have the thing entry file.
Then
we need to make sure it is not with the W at the end, because right now probably users will add the dot W at the end.
Oh yeah, so yeah, I was looking. So it's only the name of the file, but then it's tfaws.
Yes. So we can simply do a hack and use a split dot.
Yeah, that was also
already W, and then use the first argument of that. Okay.
Yeah, and then use the dot tfa aws.
Yes. Okay, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And now we are in the correct folder. They specify an AWS region, and we are also not logged into AWS yet in our workflow file. Yeah,
that's also something that we need to do.
What do we want to use for that? Do you have a recommendation?
There's an existing action. So it's AWS actions configure AWS credentials.
But this action requires to have OpenID Connect set up, or
yes. And everything else should not be used anymore.
Okay, because I think sometimes users will have AWS credentials as secrets.
Yeah, no.
Okay. And we can add that later as a parameter how to authenticate.
Yeah, let's go with
let's
the simple
imagine we use the
line why you should not use it anymore.
Yeah. So let's ask Copilot to generate an AWS login action. Yeah, that's not good. Do you know the exact name? So I can give it a little.
So that it uses AWS. Configure AWS credentials.
Let's see. Come on. Users.
There is a pass
something
error.
Like that. Which version is the current? 2.3?
I'm using master and I shouldn't. Let's call it master. It's just the latest.
It's main and not master, is it?
Is it master or main?
Fourth master. It's still master.
Latest version is 4.0.2.
Let's go with v4 then.
Sounds like it.
And now we are in the configuration phase.
And there is one setting AWS region. So AWS dash region. Yeah, just pick US East 1. It doesn't matter, it's just for the login. And as US East 1 is the one where IAM lives, we can just use that. And then we have the role to assume. No, we don't need to make this configurable at all because it's just the region that is used for login.
Okay.
And as IAM is a global service. So yes, we would need to make this configurable some point in time to use the sovereign cloud or Gov cloud or things like that. When using another partition. But I think a lot of things will break then. It's not something that is just one line change.
Okay, so, do we need something else?
Yeah, the next option is role-2-assume. Yeah, exactly that one. And that should be configurable. So we want another option. What is the IAM role to deploy per stage? So I enroll.
Okay.
Or yeah, I enroll ARNs.
And there's probably a record of stage name.
Yeah, you can write the record. You can also use the object syntax, like it's a curly braces and then specifying the key and the value. And it's just a string, yes. So it's technically the same.
Yeah, doesn't matter.
Yeah, exactly that.
Okay, so we now can access our role name by going to this.options, yeah, something like that.
That exactly. And then we, the last thing we need is the role session name. Yeah.
Maybe at the stage.
Yeah, it just needs his role session name. So, and that would be it. Downloading the artifact.
So do we now have already access to the exposed AWS variables, or do we need to map them into the run command?
So we can just now do all the AWS stuff. It just works.
Okay.
So every step after that is now logged into AWS and is able to call things.
That's cool. But we need to have a prerequisite set up that GitHub Actions is allowed to assume a role in a job,
yep.
Correct?
But that's always the case if you want to use GitHub Actions with AWS.
Okay.
We will see this a second later when we configure the permissions. We now need another permission.
Cool.
But we still need the Terraform apply, I think, needs some kind of information what stage to apply. Or is there no other thing?
I think it will use the current AWS credentials to initialize,
mm-hmm.
and then apply to the currently configured AWS account.
Yes, that's
so we assume yeah. There's no differences in the stages.
I don't get that.
Not sure how to work with CDK. It would create multiple stacks for me, and then I can pick one stack.
No, Terraform just applies all of the resources that are part of the Terraform component at the end, and it applies that in the current context of the Terraform CLI, which is the credentials that we configured up there, which is why the region becomes important at the end, right? So the region selected in line number 49 would then also be the one applied to do Terraform.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need to. That's what was in the documentation. But I'm wondering if this deploy, synthesize or compile once, deploy many. So how does configuration of stages work then?
That would mean that you would have different state files for Terraform, right? So we would need to have a state file now that we are passing to the Terraform apply, I think, not in it.
Yeah, I think a state file would be in S3 or something like that or whatever.
But we need to pass that. We need to pass that if we reuse that same deployment thing.
Yeah, I'm thinking about, let's say it creates a database. And I want in staging, I want to be at 5 gigabytes and in production, 500 gigabytes. So where does this change come from?
Usually you would do that with value files in Terraform that are environment specific, and I don't know how that works.
Yeah, so is Wing stage aware, or is it just this is my code and I want to deploy it everywhere?
I think you need to compile different artifacts for that. You can have some different branches in your wing code, maybe depending on an environment variable or some input parameters, and then it will generate different Terraform outputs, but each output is then specific for one target. But I'm not 100% sure. That's only my assumption.
Yeah. I think I'm not happy with that.
But maybe we continue with just a simple wing application and iterate on that.
Yes.
Let's assume we just deploy the same thing everywhere and then ask somebody from wing if this is if they're kidding or if this is really what they want to do.
Yes, let's do that. So the documentation doesn't state anything about stages. I was just reading that and I'm not sure if they have thought about that yet.
Okay, so that would be Terraform init, Terraform apply. We assume that state management is also done correctly in the Terraform file that is created.
Yes.
Yes.
Let's assume that for now.
Yeah. So we just need to export it, the region up front.
So we should probably add it to our configuration as well, maybe.
So this is also not part of the wing code, correct?
No.
Okay. Yeah, then we need it there.
Something like that?
Yes. Maybe we'll need to refactor that.
It's the key and the region is the value.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we now just simply replace that one with the parameter from the option.
Do you think this will... Does it set the environment variable? Yeah, let's assume. Okay.
That should be already it to deploy some basic wing application.
Not yet. There's one thing missing, and it's for the permissions. We need another permission, line 67. Which is the ID token with the permission write. I have no idea why we need to write, but it's like that.
That's for the AWS login, correct? To have the right permission that the token that is generated from the GitHub environment and injected into your job has the right permissions or the right fields in the JOT token in the to authenticate with AWS, correct?
Exactly. And then the next thing we need is a dependency setting. So we want to have a needs for compile. Yeah. It's an array.
Is there a way to reference a job name or something like that from the workflow? So whenever, because this name needs to be the same one like this one.
You could use a constant in your
file. Okay. Okay, we keep it as is, but it's not okay. I get it. Cool.
So we just need to make sure that the deploy, and I think there's an extra space that we don't want, is deploy dash space stage, and the space should go away. So we just need to make sure that compile runs first, otherwise we don't have an artifact. And I think that should be it.
Okay, so now we're done with the coding piece. We're still missing something like tests and actually trying this out, right?
Yes.
So can we synthesize already a template from what we have right now and see some output or maybe try without tests, just try to out deploy something? Or see how far we got with this template?
Yeah, so we could use the test to see what's generated. So first of all, we need to use the index TS and hook up wing. So in this file, we need to export everything from GitHub. Export star from
GitHub.
So now everything, now all the things are green.
Yes.
Now we can add a test.
In the Wingline folder or on the root folder?
In the test folder.
Oh, makes sense.
GitHub.
Scroll down.
GitHub, not GitLab, or not?
GitHub.
I can delete that one.
Basically, we would... Oh, don't...
No, don't delete it. That's an existing test. We're now going to expand the existing GitHub test to have a...
Okay, sorry.
And
what we should do, but that's something we need to do first on the main branch, is not call it GitHub test, but awsedk.github test. So we can now do a winglang GitHub test.
So let's copy that GitHub test and make it a winglang GitHub test.
Yeah. So winglang.github. I would prefix it with winglang so we know what it is. Yeah. And the first one would be the snapshot. Like creating a new project. It shouldn't be an AWS CDK TypeScript app. It should just be a GitHub project. So a new GitHub project in line 6.
GitHub project?
Yeah, the deprecated one. So this is not existing anymore. Default release branch also is not existing. That should be enough. It's a basic project without anything. It's just the project. And now, yeah, that should not be GitHub CDK pipeline, but the GitHub winglang thing.
What do we call it? Oh, it's not exported.
Oh, that's a problem. We should also export the options, otherwise it will be... That's why we're writing tests.
So now it should be somehow discoverable, yes, from the source folder, okay. And we can remove this configuration in that one as well, because we do not have provided these options, correct?
Yeah, we have the IAM roles. It's just called a bit different. We have the IAM roles per stage. Which is basically the same.
No, we have something like this.
Yeah, that role, prod role. Package namespace can go away, and for stages we just have a list of names. Let's just call it dev prod, I guess. So what else is missing? Target and ring entry file. And dot regions, yes, that's also good. Also, obviously only one possibility, and this is a main dot W. Exactly.
Okay.
And now we wanna synthesize everything, we want a snapshot, and the things that we want a snapshot is the deploy YAML, I think we called it. We don't have the release prod YAML. We don't have a package JSON, and we don't create tasks yet, so we don't need to match the tasks. And now we can just remove all the other tests in this file. So that should be the first test. Though if we run this using npx jest and the file name, no, don't go into the folder. Just call it npx jest and then the file name. So test. You should be if you do dot slash, you should be able to autocomplete. That should work.
Okay, it run and it says, unused import. Let's see if it's only the unused imports. Yay!
That looks good.
So there was one snapshot file written in the snapshot folder. We have the Wingland GitHub test file. And this is where our file lives now. We have a deploy thing with on main workflow dispatch. The first job is to compile. That's doing install, compiling, and uploading. And then we have to deploy dev. That's doing a download artifact. Dev role is used correctly. The run.
I think that isn't working, but we can modify that in a second.
Let's just use two actions.
And the deploy dev and deploy prod, I think, is pending as well, because it's gonna deploy into the same target environment at the end.
Also, it needs also the other state as a needs step.
Yeah, that's what I said, right? It needs a different state as well. It is not passing the state or stage variable to Terraform yet.
Yeah, but that should work, I think, because it has different AWS login.
If you are in different AWS accounts, then yes. Or different AWS accounts and or different AWS regions, then it would work, but otherwise it would override the existing resources.
Yeah, but as I understood, that's how Terraform works.
Okay, so maybe continue with fixing the things we are knowing that are not working correctly. So start off with the two commands. So we add two steps, take the first, call it Terraform init, and just add one line, remove the multiple lines, and like that, and use this one to deploy something and call the apply command here. And remove this step now.
Yep.
And we should have a clean synth output. And the second thing was we need to add the needs step from all the stages, the prior stages.
Yes. So what we can do is fill our own array. So having a private member field called current stages. And whenever we add one, we use the list that we already have in the needs.
So we are using basically in the iterator, we keep track of the stages.
We don't need to do anything here. We just create a new field in the class called current stages.
Okay.
Which is an empty array.
Like that?
That's correct. And then in the needs part of the deployment, no, in the deploy, that's that. bit down. I think it's 67-ish. So here, needs in 70. It needs compile, comma, exactly this dot current status map. Yes, exactly that.
And we need to edit current stages.
After, so at the last step, we do this dot current stages at stage, a push. So after the workflow add job, otherwise it will add itself as a need and that would not work. Exactly that.
Okay, so we run our tests again and update our snapshots and see our updated snapshot then.
Yeah.
So I run it automatically with the update command, so it will automatically update the snapshot file. And now we can have a look at it again, and we see that the dev has the needs of compile, and we have two steps, Terraform init and Terraform apply, and the deploy to prod now needs the compile step and the deploy to dev step, and also has the init and the deploy commands. Cool.
Cool.
Perfect.
That is good. That means minimalistic version is implemented.
Yep, we have it done.
Amazing. Now, next step would be to test this in a real project and use it in a projen project. Do we want to still do that, or do we say this is good enough? Now let's first get...
I think it has been a long ride. So we implemented it, the tests confirmed that the file looks good, and now we would need to, as you said, merge it, test it using Yalk, test it in a real project, see what happens, push some things. Not that easy with the projen project, because it would then resynthesize in the GitHub action and then figure out that it, oh yeah, it doesn't work. And things like that. So
my proposal for wrapping this up would be, let's do a commit. Then, Raphael, let's have a look on all of the changes that we implemented. Then we're going to wrap up this recording and we're going to get someone from Winglang on the call to tell us if this is actually making sense, or where do we do stages and how do we do stages. And if we get Eyal or someone to actually spend time with us explaining this and we can record that, then we're also going to learn something about Wing.
Okay. Cool. So let's go over our changes. So I think these are not very relevant, that are just formatting. So this is fine, also just formatting issue. And then in our Git view, we had
a previous commit. So we added more stuff.
Yeah.
But basically, this file is completely new.
I'm not sure how can I switch this side
let's,
by side.
Let's just commit and push, and then go to GitHub and compare there.
Yeah.
That is the best approach, I guess.
Add deploy stages. Okay, so let me create a new GitHub window. So let me quickly change my screen share so we see my browser window. It is that one. Let's increase font size and we see, okay, this is my fork of the project with my branch. Let's create a pull request. Feature add wingling pipeline. I'll open it as a draft because I'm not ready to merge it. Yeah. The...
Yeah, and reference issue number 20.
And now we can look at the changes more easily. So these are the files. I collapsed that for visibility. And what we did is, okay, we added our winglang export so we can use our new component. And we built a GitHub winglang pipeline component that gets in the following parameters: stages, target, so which stages the application should be deployed to, which target should be used for winglang. Currently we're only using Terraform AWS. Then where we start compiling our wing application, which is the entry file, and for our deployment stages in AWS, we specify which IAM roles are used and which region for each stage is used. Then we are instantiating our class, and the constructor generates a new workflow file for our workspace in our Git repository, and we modify it so that it is the workflow, GitHub action workflow, is triggered on each commit on main or manually while clicking the UI component, which is then the trigger workflow dispatch. And after we set up our workflow file, we created the create compile step. That is basically the build phase of our workflow file. And after we the compile step, it does the following. It checks out our code, installs the winglang CLI, then compiles an artifact that is deployed to the cloud, and we are uploading it so we can share it across the stage deployments, and add it to our workflow. So our first step in our workflow is the compile step. And after that, we are iterating over all the stages that are configured and adding a deploy job to our workflow file for the specified stage. And in the deploy stage, we are downloading our compile artifact we did in the compile step, and then log into AWS, run Terraform init, because we specified, we created a specific deploy command for Terraform. So we need to initialize Terraform environment. And after that, we can simply deploy our Wing application to our cloud environment.
Perfect. And as this is not yet a best practice winglang workflow, we would need to get someone from Wing to help us out and explain us a little bit more on how the strategy would be. So what am I missing executing wing tests and executing them, the integration tests as well, and then obviously deployment to multiple stages. Great. So before we kind of close this this recording, we never talked about who the hell you guys are and where people can get in contact with you and get you to do some more stuff. Let's start off with Raphael, who has been streaming on Twitch lately. That's how was that experience?
It was quite intense. It was, I think it was too long. It took like 3 hours, and I was expecting no one to show up, but then I posted it on LinkedIn and Twitter, and then there were up to 6 people in my stream asking questions. So that was quite interesting, but also quite challenging. So if you do live streams, don't expect to get too much of a progress, because if you interact with the chat, you will get distracted a little bit. But I think I will do it again.
Cool.
So besides that, I'm also an AWS community builder and user group leader for AWS. So I'm quite active in the AWS community. And if you want to get in touch with me, the easiest way would be LinkedIn, or nowadays also maybe come to one of my live streams on Twitch.
And even more important, you've been advocating for in-person meetups. So you are running the Karlsruhe meetup. You're going to be at the user group Bergstrasse again, I saw. And we're also going to be in Heilbronn soon enough, I hope. And yeah, with that, feel free to see where Raphael can be found. I think you're also talking in a lot of community days. Specifically join us in September in Munich, where Thorsten and I and you, we are all organizing a community day for the Dach community. So Thorsten, everyone I think knows you that watches this recordings, but still, like 30 seconds about yourself or two minutes.
So my name is Thorsten. I'm consulting companies on using AWS in an automated way. Only if it's automated, it's production ready. And I'm also advocating for CDK and all the progen stuff. So I'm working closely with the teams at AWS to improve these products, and also working in the Open Construct Foundation to help the community use CDK, progen, and all the tooling behind that. That's why I'm also running the Progen Pipelines project to help people build their pipelines.
Thank you so much for your time, for both of your time. That was real fun. I hope that we will continue this series around getting Wing into Progen, because we're not 100% finished yet. But next step would be to try to reach out to Wingling and get someone to help us out with that one. So thank you so much again, and talk to you soon.
Talk to you soon. See ya.